students and all those who have assembled here for the talk. We, Miyasi Academy of Architecture, are hosting the monthly lecture organized by INTACT, in which one of the renowned speakers, Mr. Gopu, will talk to us about his archaeological, numismatic, architectural, grammatical, literary, and epigraphically detective story titled Rediscovery of India's History. I now welcome architect Sujata Shankar to give an introduction about the speaker.
On behalf of INTACT, I would like to welcome all of you, and I must tell you that we've never had so many members coming for our meeting. So I think Miyasi is obviously a very attractive venue, and so there are many of us here. And one more thing I'd like to say is, many of us think heritage and conservation and preservation are all dry subjects, which are like, you know, something that is to be learnt in a classroom. But actually it is more of an Agatha Christie or a Perry Mason. I don't know who the current detectives are, but it is more of that type. And actually, when we go to buildings and when we see, try to evaluate what is there in the buildings, what is there, actually what we are doing is like detective work. So in a sense, restoration, conservation, etc. are actually like, it's like something that is fun. And it is in that spirit most of us actually enjoy whatever we are doing. Because every time we go and see something, we find so-and-so had done this, but so-and-so has changed it a little. Who changed it? So who's the culprit, sort of? So, and of course, we've never found out which butler did it. But anyway, I'm very happy and welcome all of you and for this. And I request Sujata Shankar to introduce the speaker. One last thing. Professor Altaf Ahmed, the director of Miyasi, deserves a special cheer from all of us. I have never heard him say no to anything which he feels his students will benefit from. He is the sort of the ideal host. He opens up the place, throws it, and makes us all feel welcome, and never makes us feel we are asking for a favor. Thank you, Professor Altaf.
Good evening. I hope Professor Altaf will join us midway at least. He said he would. So, today's speaker, Gopu, obtained an engineering degree in computer engineering from Arulmigu Kalasingam College of Engineering, now a deemed university in Srivalliputtur, and an MS in computer science from the Texas A&M University in College Station, Texas, USA. He then worked in the US as a software engineer, mostly at Microsoft in Seattle, but also did brief stints in Arizona and in California. Totally bored of software, he returned to his motherland. He says three books dramatically changed his way of thinking and so his life. Guns, Germs and Steel, A History of Man Before Man Started Writing History. Then The Lexus and the Olive Tree by Thomas Friedman, A Framework for Understanding Our Own Times. And then Sivagami and Savadam by Kalki Krishnamurti, which ignited a passion for temples, sculptures and Indian history, which is yet to abate. He has since been reading books on economics, evolution, genetics, linguistics, history and astronomy. He's also learning Sanskrit to be able to better understand India and our heritage. As part of the Tamil Heritage Trust, he has attended site seminars at Mamallapuram, Ajanta, Ellora, and the monuments at Pudukkottai, and most recently, Srirangam. In 2011, he visited Orissa, Bengal, and Bihar. But the most amazing was walking around Nalanda and Rajgriha, Vaishali, and Bodh Gaya, Bhuvaneshwar, and Konarak. Among the discoveries were several architectural puzzles, including isolated pillars, large mounds, later discovered as stupas, abandoned cities, caves, and extraordinarily elegant sculptures and paintings as at Ajanta, Ellora, Rajgir, Mamallapuram, etc. Some of these seem to have no relation whatever to architecture, design, or even culture. And on to Gopu to take us through this journey for our benefit. Thanks.
Good evening. Thank you. I would like to first thank Intac for inviting me to speak. For all of you for turning up at such short notice, especially those of you who had to quit work or school or whatever. I'm also delighted that Sujatha first asked me to talk about astronomy because I think she's heard me talk about it. And after I said yes, I changed my mind and said, how about this instead? It might be more interesting. There's at least a couple of buildings to show, something related to architecture. And she agreed. And I actually gave this lecture again on an even shorter notice, at least this time I had 10 days notice. At 3 days notice when I'm on my visit to Bihar, while I was in Bengal and I was going to Patna in a couple of days, my friend Ganesh who works at Indian Oil there. So we had a lot of conversations and he said, prepare something about Bihar. Tell people of Bihar about Bihar, something that they perhaps don't know. And so that's kind of how it started. But I had earlier read a book, this particular book, it's called Buddha and the Sahibs. It's not one of the three books that she mentioned. And this book substantially changed my perception on how I view the British and how much they did for Indian heritage and how much they discovered of Indian history. And it's really a story of British investigators, two or three, four persons perhaps in principle. And she was wondering about whether Perry Mason or whomever is the most popular detective. It seems to me that the Controller and Auditor General is the most successful detective right now. And some of the newspapers too. But in this case, of course, whether any culprit will be face anything is outside the realms of fiction. So anyway, in this particular case, you might be wondering what all this have to do with the detective story. And I think I'll cover some of these. I actually have to leave out a lot of information that I would like to show. So without much ado, let me start with this. So somewhere in the beginning of the 19th century, 1800 something, there was a British person trying to build a road. And a road at that time meant just a mud road. You just put a foundation and then lay some mud on it. There's no automated vehicles at that point. And so he found that this was the pillar that the workers were using. Not exactly this, I just got a photo of a similar pillar. And you could see it's somewhat cylindrical but broader at one end and narrow at the other end. And I heard reports that this was done in two different places, one in Bihar and one in Allahabad. I've not been sure which one is the right one. And then he asked the people where they found this road rolling stone, and they said, oh, they found it not too far, it's in the middle of some ruins. And then he went closer to it and he noticed some writing on it. And he said, can you read this? And he said, we are all illiterate, we don't know what this is. So they went to the nearby Brahmin Pandit. At that time, in the beginning of the 19th century, very few people could read, and most of the people could read were Brahmins. And so he asked that person, could they read it? And that person said, no, I can't read it, I don't know what writing it is. And then they asked her, but what is this? What is this piece of stone? It's superbly shaped. It's got some writing. What is it? And the best answer that the Pandit could give was that this was Bhima's walking stick, Bhima of the Panchapandavas. Now, I'll give you a slight different perspective of what this is. Can you guess? It's a pillar. Ashok pillar. Right. This one is at Vaishali. This was not the one that was used. There was one of the other ones. I think it was the Allahabad pillar that had been used, and maybe in a different pillar, maybe the Gaya pillar that was used in Bihar, I don't know. In fact, there's a story that another person, a sugarcane farm owner, cut two pieces of these stones and was using it as a sugarcane juice compressor. So that was the tragedy of the Ashokan pillar. Now, if you notice something, actually that is something that the next found out. When the guy asked the road workers, what happened, it seems cut off, where was it? And they said, oh, we found incident, I'll just leave that question quickly, but he said, they found three lines with the thing, but it wasn't very convenient for rolling, so they cut off that piece and put it to the side. And now this is the logo of the Republic of India, right? So Bhima's walking stick was the answer he gave the Brahmin Pandit, the most learned, one of the most learned persons of that time perhaps, gave because he didn't know what this was. That tells you something. Now, interestingly enough, it turns out that the pillar had not one but three inscriptions. And this was one of them. How many people here can read that? This is found in India, remember? Very good. Excellent. So there are about four people here who can, and she is one of them. Okay. Excellent. The other inscription here, incidentally they named this the Pinman script because it looked like, you know, stick figures of... this was another one. Can you read this? Actually, it turns out that it's not. It looks a little like it, right? Ha! Detectives already. The whole room of them. Good guessing. But there's a third script that they could read, not on this particular pillar, but there is a very famous pillar in Delhi, the Feroz Shah Kot La Ground. And the pillar there was called Feroz Shah's Lat, Lat being stick. And then Lat, I guess. So, and that third script was Persian and it was Feroz Shah's inscription, so they could read it. And then later on they examined Feroz Shah's document and he found out that the pillar was not originally in Delhi, but in Meerut. And he brought it from Meerut, all the way from Meerut, which is itself a feat of brilliant engineering. And installed it on his mound. And he had at that time asked his fellow Brahmin Pandit so that they could read the script and they couldn't take it. So not only in the 18th century, but even in the 14th century, not only in the 19th century, but also the 14th century, that script was a mystery. The person who eventually decoded this is this man, James Prinsep. Here he's shown exhibiting his own beautiful pencil sketch of Varanasi. He was at Benares for a bit of time, for a few years, where he was in charge of the mint there. He was what's called the assay master at the Benares mint. And so let's, in a kind of an improper segue, let me move into my philosophizing about European colonialism. Because when I read the story of how Prinsep deciphered the script, it revised my opinion of what European colonialism is. We think of European colonialism or British colonialism as a very simple thing. We consider how it affected us, right? That's pretty much the focus of the books that we read or our syllabus or our learning. But you never think about how colonialism affected the colonizers. And it affected them tremendously too. It also affected us positively in several ways, but in surprising ways. The 19th century is something that we think of as the age of discoveries, 18th century also, 20th century of course, even bigger things. But mostly we think of them as technological discoveries and scientific discoveries, like the steam engine, the railways, cotton gin, telegraph, telephone, much better understanding of, you know, biology, chemistry, physics and so on. But it was an age where whole new fields of study came into being or came into much sharper focus or developed dramatically. They had inklings of the fields before, but they really came into, you know, full-blown public exposure in the 19th century. And these would be geology, archaeology, evolution, I'm just a few of them I'm mentioning here. And some started a little earlier, some a little later, it's a hodgepodge and I'm putting up here. So, I think perhaps the British period is something that, the colonialist period, is something I would personally divide into three different segments like this. The early period when the East India Company started, until about the Battle of Plassey and Clive's conquest of Bengal, which would be as a company of traders. They were primarily a company of traders, mostly of cotton, textiles and spices in India, as far as India is concerned. But they also had some early inklings of government here in Madras and in some fragments here and there. After that period, between 1757 and 1857, we were really we sections of India were being run by a company rather than a proper government. They had to, the company had to find ways to institutionalize government because every existing structure started collapsing. But this was the great of age of, which is this kind of what I'll be, this period is what I'll be dealing with. From 1857 after the Sepoy Mutiny or the Indian War of Independence, whichever way you look at it, it was proper colonialism. The British Raj took over. It was direct government. And some of the discoveries continued, but the great discoveries, most of the great discoveries had already been made. And most of the pursuit was mostly as passion and institution, not necessarily learning, how shall I put it, a curiosity to learn was not always the driver. It was often a driver, but not always the driver. So after Clive, in 1757, Warren Hastings was appointed by the East India Company to take over as the Governor General in Calcutta. And Warren Hastings was one of those extremely broad-minded men who wanted to bring the best of perhaps Europe to India and but rule Indians with what they were accustomed to, and also to expose that some of the false myth that had been there about Indians. So this is one of his wonderful quotes: "Great pains have been taken to inculcate into the public mind," and the public there is the European public, "the opinion that native Indians are in a state of complete moral turpitude." And this is from several accounts here before. Most of the accounts were of travels and conquest and things like that. "And live in constant and unrestrained commission of every vice and crime." Now you must remember, these were Europeans who were somewhat puritanical. Christianity was still pretty strong. They took their morals from Christian virtues. They knew tremendously about Arabia and Persia and Islam, but they were substantially ignorant of India. Not many proper documents or histories about India existed. The only two documents that they had were documents of the Greek era, basically or Greek and Roman era, Strabo, Pliny, not very good ones. And later on by Marco Polo, also he barely touched India. And India had changed substantially by then. And so this was Warren Hastings' comment. Hastings then, one of the things that they did was institute a Supreme Court in Bengal to administer justice. And they used Maulvis and Pandits to explain the local laws. The judges, of course, would be British, but the plaintiffs and the defendants would be Indians mostly. And they were tried by Hindu law or Muslim law according to what their beliefs were. And they very quickly found out that the Maulvis and the Pandits were pretty corrupt. If a person could bribe them, they would happily mislead the English. At this point, the English realized that they need to translate the laws of the land, the Sharia perhaps and the Manusmriti, which were considered the laws of the land, into their language, so their lawyers and their judges would not be fooled and deliver false verdicts. So that was the principle of ruling the natives to their own laws. But some of the East India Company directors, especially the ones in London, who didn't know, they objected. They were like, "We are there to do business. Why are we not there in the business of translation? So let's buy textiles, let's govern, let's get this done with." That was their idea. So some scholars had actually come to Calcutta. India has actually had a long history of missionaries and scholars eager to learn about India, eager to do missionary work, some businessmen keen to trade. There have been histories of India which are histories of travels or brief one-person accounts of some particular city and so on. But no proper history of India existed before. There was one by Alexander Dow, but it turned out that was mostly wrong, and it was turned over by a more accurate history in 1830s. But two important people who helped Warren Hastings were Charles Wilkins, a man who had learned Sanskrit. And in 1785, he had learned so much Sanskrit that he managed to translate the Bhagavad Gita and published it. Hastings read it and he described this with this phrase: "The Bhagavad Gita is an original treatise of a sublimity of conception, reasoning and diction almost unequaled in world literature and in religious literature." Now that's a remarkable statement coming from a man who was genuinely a Christian. He admired the good stuff in Hinduism, but he was no Hindu. Another person who did some interesting work at that point was Nathaniel Halhead, and he started on this work. And Gentoo, the word Gentoo was one of the words that they used for Hindus. So he started on a code of Gentoo laws according to what he could learn from the local Bengali scholars. And he also published a grammar of the Bengali language. Imagine what effort this must have taken. But Halhed was such an interesting person, such a dedicated person. He went off on his own. This was not funded by Hastings or the East India Company. And he translated these other works that are mentioned here, the Bhagavad Purana, Shiva Purana, Mahabharata, and so on. Now, while these were important for the community in Bengal, they did not get much exposure outside Calcutta. They stayed within the confines of the East India Company until this man arrived, Oriental Jones. This man, you can compare this guy to the great giants of civilization, Isaac Newton, Archimedes, you know, Columbus, the discovery level, Darwin, you know, Aryabhatta, anybody who's dramatic, whose impact on the world is dramatic. And I'll give you a resume of, or a brief introduction to what this man was. And he was born in 1746. He was reading Shakespeare at the age of 4. At the age of 12, he was translated Ovid and Virgil, Latin poets. His Greek teacher told him that he was better than himself, that Jones was better as a better at Greek than the school teacher himself. At 20, he had acquired proficiency in French, Italian, Spanish, Portuguese, Greek, and Latin. This was at 20. The first year of college, because this language is not enough, he started studying Arabic. That's not what he was studying. I mean, that was on the side. He employed a Syrian who was living there to teach him on the side. This was, you know, and when he was learning Arabic, he found out that learning Persian was simple if you know a little bit of Arabic, so he learned Persian also. This was a pastime for him. And interestingly, the king of Denmark, King Christian VII, asked him to translate a very interesting book, Tariq-i-Nadiri. Nadir Shah was the king of Persia who invaded India, I think. And he had written his history was written by historians in Persian. And an Englishman was asked by a Danish king to translate a Persian work into French. Imagine how odd that sounds. And he was the most qualified man. And if you want to know why this guy not a Frenchman, King Louis XIV of France said, he understands the language of my people better than I do myself. This is a phenomenal human being. And he decided he wanted a career too, besides just being an expert linguist. Linguist is not necessarily someone who knows multiple languages, I guess, not in today's context. But he was admitted to the bar, he became a lawyer effectively. And then he published a grammar of the Persian language. Remember, he was sitting in London all this time. Then he published an essay on the law of bailments. So it's not like he was a bad lawyer, just a good linguist. This still stands as a major treatise, and it's not the only one. He has published others also. And by this time, he had learned 28 languages. Not necessarily the same proficiency as the first few I mentioned. But then he stood for parliament. Why, I don't know, but he did. Perhaps because, even with all his qualifications, he could not get a good job as a lawyer, or did not find the profession appealing enough. And he lost the parliamentary election. He was at this point a tutor to one of the local, sons of one of the local, some of the aristocrats. At which point he expressed a desire to come to India and serve in the Supreme Court of Bengal, which had already been established. But the Lord Chancellor was denying him the opportunity for some particular reason. Perhaps personal enmity, perhaps jealousy, whatever. So what happened was the King of England gave him a recommendation letter. He said, Lord Chancellor Thurlow, I would take your appointing Jones to the Supreme Court as a personal compliment. And 3 days later, he got the appointment with an annual salary of £30,000. 2 weeks later, he was knighted. He became Sir William Jones. A few days later, he married Anna Maria. And 2 weeks after that, he set sail for India to take up his job with his wife. He didn't leave her behind. And a few months later, he was in India. In Calcutta. He actually stopped in Madras for a couple of days and then went to Calcutta. Every time I mention Calcutta, Sriram just grins. So why he was sailing from, remember, there's no Suez Canal at this point. There's no steam shipping. He had to come by sail ship with all the dangers that it involved. And he was crossing the Arabian Sea. Why he was crossing the Arabian Sea? He realized that Arabia was to his back. Egypt and Arabia was to his back. Persia was to his left. and India lay ahead. And that he was in this middle of this vast amphitheater of great civilizations really excited him. And he came up with a list of things that he wanted to study, things that he wanted to accomplish. You see, because he had not accomplished anything so far, so he wanted to accomplish a bunch of things in the future. And these are the things that he wanted to accomplish. He wanted to publish the laws of the Hindus and the Mohammedans. He wanted to write a history of the ancient world, that is all of Asia basically. He wanted to come up with proofs and illustrations of the scripture, here the Bible. He wanted to explore traditions concerning the deluge, the great flood that is mentioned in almost every religious manuscript. He wanted to describe or write a book about the modern politics and geography of Hindustan, a text on the best mode of governing Bengal, the arithmetic, geometry and mixed sciences of the Asiatics, the medicine, chemistry, surgery, anatomy of the Indian. I mean, this is just insane. Any one of this is a lifetime's work for a person. And here this man is saying, I want to do all this, and he's, and that's just half the list. Right. Because it doesn't fit into one thing, you can't see all of it. So, more natural products of India, the poetry and the rhetoric, it just keeps going. The best accounts of Tibet and Kashmir, Mughal administration, Maratha constitution. Marathas did not have a constitution, but he wanted to write about the Maratha constitution. So, this is all the things that he wanted. You can see what he was. Tremendous things. Jones sailed when he left London, he was a celebrity. When he came to Madras, he was a celebrity. When he went to Calcutta, he was a celebrity. And he was received with, a 21-gun salute by the Calcutta, the East India Company at Calcutta. The Supreme Court came, the Supreme Court was just four or five people at that point. The Chief Justice received him. And to continue on Warren Hastings' project of educating the country and so on, and translating the language, he wanted to learn Sanskrit. But at that time, the two people I mentioned, Charles Wilkins and Nathan Halhead, turns out that they were his classmates in college. They were colleagues from his earlier days in London. And so he hooked up with them. He didn't bother learning Sanskrit because Charlie Wilkins was there, the Sanskrit scholar. So he just referred to Wilkins whenever he wanted it. And in the first year, some very interesting, I mean, he set up a house. We have a description of his daily routine. He would get up very early in the morning. He would take he would walk 3 miles. He would take a bath. Then he'd invite his lawyers and assistants to prepare his documents, hear some plaintiffs and so on. Then he'd prepare for court, go to court, hear, you know, after breakfast of course, and then he'd hear cases from 10 to 3 or something like that. At 3 o'clock, the British custom, which is American custom also, they dine pretty early. We call it lunch, they call it dinner in the afternoon. So he would dine, then he'd take a nap or a rest, and then the rest of the evening, he would spend reading, learning, talking to people, finding out things. This was his routine. He had taken 2 lambs from India. From England for the table, but he decided to use them as pets instead because he grew fond of them. And on the way he also acquired a goat and a tiger cub. So this was his daily bedroom scene. The tiger cub was motherless, the goat was milching, so the tiger cub would suckle at the goat would suckle the tiger. And one of the persons who visited him, Captain Twining or Corporal Twining at that point, was so awed by him, he went to his house, they had dinner. And at that point, suddenly in the middle of dinner, Jones started calling, Othello, Othello. Othello, of course, the famous ship. So now he's wondering, who's Othello? Some slave? Some servant? Some Hindu servant? Muslim? He looks all around to see where this Othello is going to come from. And Othello comes walking on all fours. It turns out that Othello was his pet turtle. He walked up the table and he fed some scraps off the table. So this was the life he was leading. So, Jones, on a whim or on a desire to learn more about India, took a boat and travelled to Benares and back at that point. From Calcutta to Benares, that's a bit of a distance, remember, it took 3 months or so like that. And one of the things, what is most precious possessions of this on this particular trip, was that he got a copy of the Manusmriti. At this point, Charles Wilkins decided to go back to England. For some reason, he went to stay in Benares for a little while and then he decided to go back to England. So now there is no scholar to consult, and Jones decided that he must learn Sanskrit. He asked the local Brahmins, who are the only ones who really knew Sanskrit, and none of them would teach him. They wanted the monopoly on Sanskrit, and suddenly they are not going to teach Mlecha, however high and mighty he might be. A foreigner was of an impure caste, and they are not going to teach him Sanskrit. But he found a person called Ramlochan, who was a Vaishya doctor, who agreed to teach him. And why he learned Sanskrit? He knew Persian, but I don't know if he translated the Muslim laws into English. I think there are other people who knew Persian also. The Muslims had no objection to teaching people Persian, so that was not an issue. He got the Muslim's law translated into English. He started working personally on the Manusmriti while he was learning from Ram Lochan. The publishing of these books, or the opening up out of these books and familiarizing the judges with the Hindu laws and the Muslim laws, bypassing the Maulvis and the Pandits, turned out to be unpopular with the Maulvis and the Pandits because their bakshish was affected. But it was very popular with the general public because now they had a fair hearing. So they were delighted. Today I guess that's a little less unlikely. So once he learned Sanskrit, once he had developed it and started publishing Manusmriti, the Brahmins started clamoring to teach me. There's no point stopping anymore, and there was money down the road, so they started clamoring to teach him Sanskrit. I duplicated the slide, that's all this. Incidentally, the Brahmins who taught him Sanskrit did not realize that he had, what a master linguist he was, how many languages he knew, what background he had, that this man was a master of languages. Incidentally, he was also helped dramatically because he found out that it was very similar to Latin and Greek. The grammatical structure, the vocabulary of Sanskrit was substantially similar to Latin and Greek. Others had observed this before, but not all others were William Jones. He was William Jones after all. And he was so good that he would write some Sanskrit verses. And the teachers would, the pundits would ask their children, look at this man's poem, learn this, it's wonderful. So the student started becoming the teacher to the teacher's children. So naturally, a little later, he had started the Asiatic Society. At one of the meetings, he made this observation. The Sanskrit language, whatever its antiquity, is of a perfect structure, more perfect than the Greek, more copious than the Latin. That means there are more books in Sanskrit than in Latin. More exquisitely refined than either, yet bearing to both a stronger affinity. So they resemble, it resembles those languages. In roots of verbs and forms of grammar, then can have possibly been produced by accident. Now every one of these phrases is a powerful statement by itself. The sum of these phrases is one of the most dramatic denouements in the history of the world, in the history of literature, in the history of discovery, in the history of civilization, certainly in the history of linguistics. We can proudly call Jones the father of linguistics because comparative philology, which is what they called it at that point, effectively this was the foundation of that movement. We talk about Rajinikanth's punch dialogues now. Every line here is a punch dialogue, and at a true literary level. And not just that, He's telling this to whom? To Europe. That here is a Sanskrit language, the language of uncivilized Indians, that is more perfect than the Greek and more copious than the Latin. It's a pretty dramatic statement to make. And it would have been completely ignored if anybody other than somebody of William Jones' stature had made the statement. And so strong, he said, have they been, are the connections, that they may have some common source. The Greek, Latin and Sanskrit had so many common bases in the affinity of verbs and the forms of grammar that they must have had come some common source, perhaps long since gone, perhaps long since vanished. And there is reason to believe that Celtic, Gothic is Old German, and Old Persian, that is Avestan, the language of the Parsis, the Zarathustran people, the people who were occupying Persia before the invasion of Islam. And that these three languages also must have had the same origin as Sanskrit, but he was not on that very sure ground here. And so, this is a dramatic statement. And he made the statement in the third meeting of what was an institution that he called the Asiatic Society of Bengal, which he founded in 1784, shortly after he arrived there. He had arrived in September 83, and in January 84, 4 months later, he started this institution. The difference between people who came before him and Jones was that Jones systematized and institutionalized the research into India in a way that, you know, only I think very few people have done. Darwin did that, I think, for biology. Perhaps the Royal Society did that for the sciences in general. Of course, Panini did it for grammar in one way, but that was an individual effort perhaps. He had very quickly discovered that chess and algebra are of Indian origin. Not really algebra, but the basis of algebra. And he wrote a treatise on music, on the Indian music. He found out that India had a seven-tone scale, the septatonic scale. He wrote a treatise on that. He translated the Shakuntala. This took Europe by storm. The first translation of Shakuntala that Jones published went to Europe, and it took every place by storm, especially the Germans at that time. Goethe was the famous poet of the time. He was the master. Goethe, Schopenhauer, Schiller, they were all overwhelmed. A great treasure has been found, marvelous things, Jones, accomplishment of Jones, India's master to the world, a civilization that is a fountain of culture. They were just exaggeration, praise, honesty, you know, bewilderment, exhilaration. And Gibbon, the famous historian who had written The Decline and the Fall of the Roman Empire, who was already an admirer of Jones, he was a colleague of Jones before Jones came here, all these people. And then he made one more statement. He compared Kalidasa to Shakespeare. William Jones said, Kalidasa is the Shakespeare of India. Now this launched the inevitable action. They could admire a culture from far, but the chauvinists at that point could not take that. How could you compare anybody anywhere to Shakespeare of all people? And they said, Jones had become Brahmanized. He is a pagan. The pagan culture has converted him. Actually, not even close. He was still a Christian. He was just a very broad-minded person. If there was one person who was Brahmanized, he was a colleague of Jones called Hindu Stewart. I think he was a general called Hindu Stewart. They called him, Tolly Stewart is his name. They call him Hindu Stewart because he immediately adopted a lot of Hindu customs. And he wrote a scandalous article in Calcutta in one of the magazines. I don't know which particular newspaper. He said that Western women should give up their ornate and starch ironed dresses and adopt the sari, because it would amply display the natural charms of women which the God intended them to do. So he was interested in the architectural form of the female body. This caused, you can imagine what scandal this caused in the beginning of the... So that was a man who could probably call Brahmanized. Jones made actually an interesting observation when he traveled all around Hindu temples. He saw a lot of romantic and erotic scenes. And he says, it's in the Hindu mind, it seems that what is in nature is not necessarily abhorrent. This is natural, so it's not abhorrent. It's a very interesting observation. We have today become westernized, while they have, Western civilization has become Indianized, if you look at where we are in terms of morality. And finally, one more great, I mean, he also came up with a beautiful orthographic form, what you call the letter form, an alphabetical notation for Sanskrit, a transliteration scheme for Sanskrit, and almost every Indian language using Roman letters, which was one of his great achievements. Finally, he identified Sandrocottus as Chandragupta. Who's Sandrocottus? I'll come to Sandrocottus in a second. So his very first article, actually, Jones's article in Asiatic Society's journal, was a dissertation on the orthographic of Asiatic words and Roman letters. And he made an observation that the ancient Greeks have strangely disguised the proper appellations of countries, cities and rivers in Asia. They had a habit of molding foreign names to a Grecian form and giving them a resemblance of some derivative word in their own tongue. And this is what he meant. So they would turn the Gogra, that's the Gagra I think, into the Agoranis. So any word that they saw, we know that the English severely mutilated some of our places, right? Edinburgh becomes Egmore, Thiruvallikane becomes Triplicane, Trivandrum becomes Trivandrum and so on, right? So the Greeks of that time went one step further. They would turn it into an actual Greek word. It must mean something, not just be a similar sounding word. So Ucha became Oxytraci, and Oxytrachi rather, and Renos into Aranos, and all these things. So that's how the Ganga becomes the Ganges, and the Sindhu becomes the Indus, because they are turning it into forms that they can recognize. And Airavati became Ravi, I think, or something else, Hydaps or something like that. Airavati? So all kinds of things. No, not the Airavati of Burma, the Airavati of the Punjab, I think. So several things. I mean, anybody who's read Periplus of the Erythrian Sea or accounts of their names would know with fulfilling what this means. So, and the Greeks of course were important because of Alexander. Alexander was really their one clue to India. They all Europeans knew that Alexander had invaded India. By the way, between 500 and the fall of the Roman Empire and about 1200, the rise of Fibonacci and the Italian states, actually the Europeans had gone through a dark ages. At that point, the Turkish invasion of Turkey and then Spain, Cordoba, and the Islamic Empire there had actually enlightened them. They had restored all the documents that the Europeans had lost. So Aristotle, Socrates, Plato, all the people, Livy, all the Romans and the Greeks that the Europeans had forgotten were now found discovered in Persian Arabic translations and original Greek documents that the Muslims had held, Arabs had held for several hundred years. So they relayed the seeds, and later of course the Europeans paid their full debt when they discovered Sumeria and Egypt and the past of these areas. So Alexander conquest, we know that he came all the way up to India. Something happened with Porus. The Western version is that he defeated Porus. In the Greek theology, actually in the Greek documents, they say that the god Dionysus came to India, gave India the religions, that gave India the, you know, the languages, and then went back. So that was, the Jones shouldn't believe this. And that was their knowledge of India at that time. This was Strabo's map from 25 BC. That little blob that you see is India. Can you see it?
This is India. This is Arabia. This is Sri Lanka. They had no idea what this looked like. This was their
view of the world around the time of Alexander and even after the time of Julius Caesar. This is 300 years after Alexander. Strabo was a Roman historian. So Alexander, from Alexander's time, besides knowing that he invaded India, they knew that he was succeeded by somebody called Seleucus Nicator, who established the Seleucid Empire here in the northwestern Indian part, and also in Persia and Iran, Iraq. And Seleucus Nicator fought a battle with the king, which he lost. Then he sent an ambassador to the king, a person called Megasthenes, who famously wrote the Indica. But the Indica was lost, and the only way the Indica was reconstructed was from the writings of people like Strabo and Pliny. And the king that he sent an ambassador to embassy to was a person called Sandrocortes, which is what Jones was talking about. And Sandrocortes was known, but not his Indian name. And Sandrocortes ruled in Palibothra, where the Ganges and the Erenna Boas unite, the two rivers. And Megasthenes mentioned, and so does Strabo, that Erenna Boas was one of the very large rivers. So it's not Ganges and Ganga and a small river, but a very large river meeting. Now there was some confusion. Where does the Ganga unite with two rivers? Well, unite with another major river. The one we know famously is of course Allahabad or Prayag. The other candidate at that time was a city called Kannauj. But it was to Jones's credit, but that he stumbled upon a story called story about Chandragupta. And the story narrated how Chandragupta overcame a kingdom and established himself at Pataliputra. And Pataliputra and Sandrocortes and Pataliputra, he seemed to make that connection. But he didn't make the connection right away. He made the connection that Erenna Boas must have been Hiranyabahu. Remember, he was both proficient in Greek and in Sanskrit. And he knew Hiranyabahu is a Sanskrit word for golden arm. And the Hindi word for gold is Son, which is what the river is known by now, Sona. Now, the only problem is the Son and the Ganga do not meet at the site of any great city. Today, it's 20 kilometers away from Patna. But another geographer at that point said that the river had changed its course somewhere in the past. So there might have been something there. And so with some degree of certainty, and he found a mention of Sandrocortes. And this clinched it for Jones. And he made the derivation that Sandrocortes is Chandragupta. And so his correct guess was that Pataliputra is Patna. Now after Ramlochan, he got access to a person called Radhakanta Sharma, who showed him a book called the Rajavamsa, which he showed a history of kings from Abhimanyu, from the Mahabharata, to Devapala. We don't know how reliable this book is, or this manuscript is, or whether it's still available. And Jones, working from his knowledge of Christianity, remember, geology is not, is still in its infancy here. He still viewed the world as a Christian world, with the world originating at 4000 BC in Bishop Usher's calendar. And so he thought this must have happened at 2029 BC and all the way up to Devapala 23 BC. And somewhere in the middle, a great great teacher called Bhud or Sakya Simha was mentioned. This was a king who became a teacher. This was a surprise. And so he asked around, who is Bhud? Nobody knew. Let me say it again. He asked around who was Bhud in India and nobody knew. There was no sign of Buddhism left in India. Jones was on wild guesses. He saw some curly haired pictures. Now he actually encountered a person. Some Burmese pilgrims had come to India, to Gaya. They had converted a Buddhist to a Christian there, or a Christian to a Buddhist, I'm not sure which. And that person told him that there was a great teacher called Buddha, and that was the person whose statues you see all over Gaya. There are little statues of Buddha in both Gaya. And he says, this is who it is. But the locals were worshipping it as a Shiva temple. The Buddha temple, the both Gaya was converted into a Shiva temple. It was being supervised by a Mahant. They didn't do any destruction. They just said, this is Bhagavan, and they were praying to the various statues of Buddha. They put vermilion, kumkum, flowers, light lamps, whatever way they knew, smoke hookah, ganja, do all the stuff that the North Indians do also. All that thing was happening. Now Jones at this point thought, looked at that, and this is the point when all the astounding revelations are coming from Elephanta, from Ellora. Other large monuments were being discovered. In fact, one of the earliest things that you'll see is the Mahabalipuram monuments were also discovered. That was the first historical document presented to the Asia Study. And he thought, who are the great constructors? Obviously the Egyptians. So Indians must be descendants of the Egyptians. This Sakya Simha is no doubt a corruption of Sesostris, the Egyptian god, or the Ethiopian Sisak. And the curly hair and the dark statues made him sure that Buddha was an Ethiopian or a Somali. And so Indians were migrated Ethiopians or Egyptians. And we had people called the Mishras. There are Brahmins called the Mishras. And Misr is both the old Egyptian name and the Indian name for Egypt. So he thought, blindingly obvious. This was the cluelessness that Jones faced, the greatest scholar of his time. On top of this, one of his colleagues called Wilford had found a person. Remember the Pinman script I said you couldn't find, but one lady here could decipher, which he was looking for, and nobody could decipher that, didn't know what language it was. One man in Benares said that he knew how to decipher it. So Wilford showed him the copies of the documents that they made, at the stamp patches that they took at Ellora, at Bodh Gaya, at some of these pillars. And he said, this is the secret code of the Pandavas. When the Pandavas wandered all over, they left messages for each other in a secret code. I have a copy of the code and I will tell you. And he never showed him the code book, but he gave them translations, very fanciful, imaginative translations. And Wilford was fooled for 10 years. And he sent magnificent, wonderful tales. And Jones was also fooled. And some of these false stories continued to perpetuate in the journals of the Asiatic Society for several years, until finally it was revealed to be a hoax. So there are also some early hoaxes, some early missteps. But look at what he was working with. The pillar of Ashoka was the walking stick of Bhima. In fact, one person said it was the bang bowl, the mortar and pestle bang bowl of Ashoka, of Bhima. But when somebody built a Christian church, Bhima got angry and threw away the bowl into the Ganges, and so only the pestle of the mortar remained. So this was the fanciful stories that they are making of. Fascinating stuff. And of course, the first monument that the Asiatic Society dealt with was the monuments at Mahabalipuram, which were discovered before Jones came here in 1772 by William Chambers. And the paper was presented in 1784, I think. And also pictures were actually shown in 1789 and 99. This is actually a 1799 picture by the Daniels brothers, which I borrowed from Dr. Swaminathan, who's here. Now, this was another puzzle. Just like the earlier Sakya stupa that I showed, the Vaishali monument that I showed, it was just a mound of bricks, right? You saw earlier. Is that architecture? Is a pillar architecture? Is this architecture? They are trying to understand architecture also. Remember, that was one of the goals of Jones. This is a single monument. Is this a sculpture or is it architecture? That's the building. They had huge puzzles to deal with. But we'll come to architecture later if I have the time. So, while this was happening, another man called, let me see if I think I have rearranged some of the, okay, I'll get back to this. While Jones was doing all this, why did nobody know about Buddha? Because there are no Buddhists in India. Fine, but there are Buddhists in Nepal, Buddhists in Thailand, Buddhists in Burma, Buddhists in all over the place, Japan, China, right? Europeans had mostly not gone there. Sri Lanka was a Dutch possession, and the Dutch did not learn much about the Buddhists, and before that there had been a Portuguese possession. They weren't in communication. The Europeans, the Dutch and the Englishmen were rivals. The East India Company of the England and the East India Company of the Dutch were business rivals. And the Dutch East India Company, they did some work, but not too much discussion on the Buddhist monuments there. In the meanwhile, a person called Francis Buchanan, who was a botanist, had gone to Burma and back to meet the king, but he wasn't successful. But he saw a temple there, a Buddhist stupa temple. Then he came back to India and he said, that was where he learned that there is some god. He thought that was also a Hindu temple, but he found out that it was a temple for a Hindu god, not Brahma, but Booth. So this is the first clue. But Buchanan had still not contributed too much to the Asiatic Society. Buchanan then came to Gaya and then came to Rajagriha. This is the capital of Bimbisara. This is a city in Bihar now. This is Gritakuta Hill. It looks like any other hill, right? Buddha lived here for several years. And Mahavira also lived here for 15 years. The top of, on top of the hill, there is a stupa for the modern stupa built by the Japanese recently. But up this hill is this tiny little cave. I'm showing you this with me in it because I want to get a feeling of the size of the cave. It's really the height of one man standing, perhaps a little less. And in this cave, Buddha stayed for a long time. And on this hill, he taught Bimbisara, the first private sermon to a king. It's a very anonymous little hill. There's nothing to mark it unless you ask a local tourist guide. You can see the gold flecks on the walls. That's all the pilgrims from the Buddhist countries come there. They bring gold and rub it on the walls because that is their way of devotion. Like you put coins in rivers or in a hundiyal, they rub gold. The entire hill is covered with gold like this, gold foil. I don't know if it's real gold or alloys or whatever, but it looks golden. And this is a Buddhist monastery on the hill that was established 1,000 years after Buddha. I mean, it was there 1,000 years after Buddha. And as you can see, it says, Huan Sang may have visited this in the 7th century AD. Nothing there. That rubble you see, that's it. That's what remains of the monastery. And in this, the most famous teacher of India, the Buddha, outside India of course, taught the greatest king of his time, Bimbisara, his sermon. And that's what this place looks like today. So in other regions of India, like I said, they had discovered the caves of Ellora. This is what Bodhgaya looked like when Francis Buchanan first went back. This is what it looks like today. This was the Sarnath Stupa. This is outside Varanasi, which also Francis Buchanan encountered, and he didn't know what it was. He couldn't find out. Is this, how do you guess? You cannot make an architectural guess. The best guess that you could get was a very large Shivalinga. That was the best guess they could get. And then they discovered in Bhopal, somebody just, I don't remember who it was, the stupa of Sanchi. And this is what it looked like then. And now, thanks to the ASI and the British, this is what it looks like now. Puth. They went to Thailand and they found out there was a person called Puth, also called Kodam. This is Buddha, Gautama Buddha, translated into Puth and Kodam. So, but by this time, this is a little after Jones, they had discovered that a lot of, they thought Buddhism was a dead religion. In fact, Jones thought that Buddhism preceded Hinduism. Hinduism overtook Buddhism the way Islam was overtaking its earlier religions in Egypt and Arabia and Persia, or Christianity did in Europe. And that, but to other people's shock, they found out, because this is when they started exploring Burma, they started going into Thailand, they learned about the Buddhist histories of China, they were learning about other places. And while Buchanan, whom I just showed, he discovered Bodhgaya and that festival, he actually stayed at Nalanda, he found few statues, but he didn't realize what he was sitting on. Nalanda was properly excavated 60 years later by Alexander Cunningham. So he had gone to Gaya and Rajgir. At this point, another astounding person called Brian Houghton Hudson had gone to Nepal. Hudson is probably as dramatic a person as Jones or Prinsep. He lived for 80 years or 70 years, something like that, in Nepal. He was the premier scholar of Buddhism that the world had seen until that point. He was not originally a Buddhist. And he was the person who said, there is Buddhism in Nepal. And that was the first encounter with proper Buddhism in Nepal, not in Sri Lanka or Burma. And so he was also a person who had seen some of these pillars. And so he made some notes and sent them to the Asiatic Society. And then a proper understanding of Buddhism really came to them only in 1834. Remember, Jones came to India and started the Asiatic Society in 1784. The proper understanding of Buddhism and what the monuments of India stood for, what the Indian monuments of Buddhism stood for, really came to them only in 1834, when two French travelers discovered the documents of the travel documents of Fahian and Hun Sen and translated them to French and then into all the other European languages. So they decided to wait until that point. By this time they knew who the Buddha was, they knew that Buddha had something to do with Gaya, that he had something to do with Sanchi and Sarnath, but not a whole lot. Very rarely would pilgrims from the Buddhist countries come to India, and only very rich ones, and still barely searching for places. While this was happening here, the rest of the world was going through its own
historical
developments. Adam Smith had published The Wealth of the Nations, a whole new field. Economics was started off. The American War of Independence was fought and won. The French Revolution had not only happened, it had also failed, and Napoleon had become a king. The French invaded Netherlands, which means Sri Lanka was no longer is open for the British to conquer. Then Burma, Thailand, Indonesia and Tibet were explored. Stamford Raffles started his adventures in Penang. The seed of Singapore had started. Java had been conquered by the British. Before Napoleon got defeated himself, of course, he invaded Egypt. And in Egypt, the pyramids were thrown open to the world. The mysteries of the pyramid were solved. This took 20 years. They were deciphered by Champollion, a French scholar. He found the Rosetta Stone. He discovered the hieroglyphics. He explained the lost mysteries of 3,000 years of Egyptian history. This is Champollion. The cuneiform script of the whole civilizations in Sumeria had been discovered. Minoan Crete had been explored. Sumeria revealed its wonders. Babylon revealed its wonders. They are still deciphering the cuneiform script. I don't think they deciphered it by that time. Persia was revealing its wonders. So I'm going to quickly jump, because one, I'm a solid half an hour behind where I wanted to be, and two, we'll come to the interesting part of the detective story. I'll try to finish on time. So go Rajinikanth speech. So after Jones, there were some great members of the Asiatic Society. Really, it's very difficult to cover the entire story in a 1 hour presentation, but I'm trying to give you as much as possible. I know I'm overwhelming you with names and locations and puzzles and stuff like that. So he was followed by Colebrook, who is considered the greatest Sanskritist. Colebrook translated some of the mathematical works and some of the other works of India, including Brahmagupta. In fact, I think it's the only translation of Brahmagupta we still have. He explained the mathematics of India in a very detailed way. There was Ellis, Francis White Ellis in Madras, who himself was lost and only recently discovered, who discovered, just like Jones had discovered the Indo-European group of languages, he discovered the Dravidian group of languages. His colleague William Marsden studied the Malayo-Polynesian languages of languages of Malaysia and Indonesia, and discovered the Malayo-Polynesian languages. You also discovered that the language of the Gypsies was an Indo-European language derived from perhaps some early precursor of Sanskrit. There was Colonel James Todd, a collector of coins, who was avidly collecting coins all over the place. He had a collection of 20,000 coins by this time. And he also was doing a great research on the Rajputs. Todd lived with the Rajputs and learned a lot about them. H.H. Wilson, who preceded Prinsep as the assay master, the mint supervisor at Calcutta. He was also the president of the Asiatic Society just by the time, who was himself a giant in his own way. Hodgson, of course, in Nepal. And two very interesting characters. James Prinsep, who succeeded Wilson, whose photo I showed at the very beginning, who did a tremendous book on Benares with all the dark drawings and all that. And James Prinsep started off as an architect. He had excellent mechanical skills, apparently. So at a very young age, he created a 6-inch stagecoach, you know, like a horse-drawn carriage, with windows, doors, springs. All these windows and doors would open and close. It had steps, and the steps would open or fold on command. And he managed to do that in a 6-inch box. And this was when he was a kid. But doing things like this ruined his eye, so he kind of affected his early attempts to become an architect. He declined the position as a cadet in the Indian Army, or the East India Company's Army, but took up this job as a assay master. Prinsep would turn out to be one of the greatest discoverers of Indian history. But he was not a scholar of Jones's caliber. What he was a scientist, which Jones really wasn't. And then another person called Alexander Cunningham, whose great merit, besides being a brilliant fellow like these two, Jones and Prinsep, was that he lived twice as long as them. They all died when they William Jones died when he was 48, Prinsep died when he was 40. Cunningham managed to live in his 80s, up to his 80s. And he made tremendous discoveries. So between this period, I am jumping from 1784 or so to the 1830s, when Prinsep really came into the Asiatic Society in 1832. In these 50 years, the mystery of the Ashokan pillar had still not been solved. Buddhism was beginning to reveal itself, but there are a whole bunch of other discoveries which I'll talk about. But there was a dramatic change. Bending had become the Governor General of Bengal or India. Thomas Babington Macaulay had become a very influential politician in the British Parliament. John Stuart Mill, the great utilitarian, had become the leading light of British philosophy. But in India, the British defeated Tipu Sultan, they defeated the Marathas, they had defeated Napoleon in England, they conquered, got back Egypt, the steam engine had been discovered, invented, vaccination in the 1790s, geology was making leaps under Charles Lyell, the guru of Charles Darwin. Public schooling had become a major factor. Only in the turn of the 18th century, most people don't realize this, what we think of as public schools, corporation schools, municipal schools, that's only 200 years old. Before that, all schooling was private. Very rarely would people go to schools, public with common education. Public schooling actually started in Prussia, which is modern Germany, or a province of it. And then it was quickly adopted through the rest of Europe. So at least most people had what you'd call a grammar school education. They would have a minimum education for up to 6 years. Also, paper was widespread in Europe, which was not in India. Only in the 19th century, paper started being adopted. Two major things. And the evangelicals, who were very, very upset that the Hindus and Buddhists were being talked very highly of by Jones and the Asiatics, were really upset. They wanted Christianity to be brought into India, which was fiercely resisted by the company and by the scholars on different grounds. The company because it affected their business, the scholars because it wounded their sense of righteousness or rightness. The utilitarians under John Stuart Mill, who thought they were the right ones. And finally, all this boiled down into white superiority, up to a point where they are almost trying to destroy the Asiatic Society. Funding got cut off. They got a major bankruptcy happened. When Prinsep came to power, became the president, there was a 13,000 rupee shortage, a dramatic collapse. There were several business collapses. Enormous number of things was happening. A very strange thing happened. The Nawab of Awadh came to the rescue of the Asiatic Society, and he gave them a big grant. A Bengali local Raja gave them some money. And then, at the peak of this thing, Bentinck was recalled, and a more friendly governor general called Auckland, who was much more sympathetic, took power, and he was very sympathetic to Prinsep, so the Asiatic Society was saved. In the meanwhile also, coin collecting became a major. I mean, the period of Jones and Colebrooke and Wilson was substantially one of trying to learn Indian history from literary sources. Now, literary sources turned out to be not very honest or not very true, as the Abhimanyu to Devapala history told us, showed us. These people were trying to gather a second set of evidences, and most of this was in coins. They were also doing some excellent excavations. Wilson and Todd, of course, Wilson was the master of the mint, so he knew how to handle coins. At this point, by this point, a number of coins of Roman coins and Greek coins were being discovered all over the Punjab, Rajasthan, what's today Pakistan, Rawalpindi, Afghanistan, those places. A lot of archaeology was going on all over these places. The discovery of the Greek and Roman coins was a big puzzle, but it also exposed that after Seleucus Nicator, there were Greek kingdoms in India for a substantial period of time, and it also exposed another dynasty, a dynasty called the Shakas. This is actually the Indo-Greek king Agathocles. This is a coin of Balarama, that figure is Balarama, I think, and it has Agathocles on one side in the Greek script. And I think it's in Karoshti in the other, right? No, it's Brahmi. So, this discovery, so incidentally, they also discovered that Sanskrit was being written in a second script, Karoshti. The coins of the Satavahana dynasty in the south were discovered, which had two inscriptions which were not properly deciphered at that time. The coins of the Kushanas, and this was when this dynasty was discovered. There was a big excavation near Taxila and another at Manikyala, I think. And this exposed a bunch of stupas and a bunch of coins which showed that the dynasty called the Kushanas, Chinese dynasty, had invaded. Or also another dynasty called the Shakas, before the Kushanas, had invaded. I'm skipping quickly through this. This requires a lecture by itself. But I'm just showing you what else was being explored at this point. So Prinsep and Cunningham, the great discoveries. Like I said, Jones exposed India to Europe. So Indians knew things about themselves, and what Jones said really was a discovery for the Europeans to learn about India while staying at home. But Prinsep and Cunningham discovered India for the Indians. They dug up the past that India had forgotten for 2000 years, and they gave us our history. And this is really one segment of that particular detective story. So one of the sculptures that the second script that I showed you after the first one, which was actually something called Brahmi, on the pillar of Ashoka, there are three inscriptions. One was in the script, the Pinman script that nobody could decipher. The other was in a kind of a primitive version of Devanagari, which turned out to be what they called the Gupta Brahmi. And this they deciphered, and it turned out to be talk about a king called Samudragupta. Now they tried to connect this with Chandragupta from Jones's connection. How many people know the difference between the Samudragupta and Chandragupta? Was Chandragupta a Maurya king or a Gupta king? It's still a puzzle for a lot of people. I think we studied history and we forget. Actually, there were two Chandraguptas who were Guptas and one Chandragupta who was a Maurya. And this is probably why it causes the confusion. But the inscriptions of the pillar said that Samudragupta is of the Solar dynasty, Surya Vamsa. But the Chandragupta book that Jones had stumbled upon said that Chandragupta was of the Lunar dynasty. And all the king's sons and so on that he mentioned had nothing to do with any of the lineages that Samudragupta seemed to mention. But they both mentioned Pataliputra. They both had their capital in Pataliputra. And they both had written on the same inscription, on the same pillar. Right? And actually, that was not known then. But later it was. So then they found out that these pillars, Ashokan pillars, was scattered all over India. It was not just Allahabad and Varanasi and Vaishali and Delhi. These pillars were there for a very large region, over 1,000 miles. What would prompt somebody? And they all had the same Pinman writing. Not only that, they also found the same writing on several rocks. And these were as far as the Nepali border at Lauriya Nandangar, in rock cuts in Bhubaneswar in Orissa, Dhauli also in Orissa, Girnar in Gujarat, and way down south in the Andhra region and in the Karnataka region, they found the same inscription. And they also found something, I think, in Takshashila. This was a very, very vast, widespread set of things of some language which was completely unknown to the Indians. And 50 years this had remained a mystery. Now, they also discovered some of these in slabs in Bodh Gaya and in a stupa in Sanchi. Prinsep actually tried to thought that it was Sanskrit, an earlier form of Sanskrit, and tried to solve it based on his deciphering of the Samudragupta script, the Gupta Brahmi, but he failed at it. Now, what the stupa at Sanchi, so this is Feroz Shah's slot. This is actually one of the Ashokan pillars with his capital cut off, with Feroz Shah reinstalled, but Samudragupta had also already written on, originally found in Meerut or Ambala, I'm not sure. This is the edict at Dhauli. This is a long rock. This is Ashoka's edicts actually. This is in a place called Kondagiri Caves in Bhubaneswar, and the arrow points to where the actual inscriptions are. And this was also in the Pinman script, but this was not actually Ashokan. This was by a dynasty called the Karavela dynasty. So, Prinsep chanced upon short inscriptions of the Sanchi Stupa on the pillar railings. There are small things, like two or three words, and they all ended with the same three symbols. I haven't shown you the symbols. He guessed that the last three letters were the last letter of a word sa, and the last word was danam. So somebody's donation. Then he thought, these are all in Buddhist. We have now learned that some of his friend Turner, who was there in Sri Lanka, said the Buddhists seem to speak a language called Pali. Their documents are all in a language called Pali. And they had learnt about Pali from Burmese sources and Nepali sources, because Hodgson was telling them all this. And they said, okay, so this must be Pali, previous Prakrit, not Sanskrit. So instead of the Sanskrit attempt, he decided it must be Pali. Let me guess in Pali. And Danam, he guessed, must have been a Buddhist practice of giving gifts. So that's what he was guessing. He said, this must all mean the words Danam. So he was guessing with these three letters. Once he guessed these three letters, Issa means is the Pali version of Isya. So suppose your name is Rama and you gave a Danam, it would be Ramasya Danam. In Pali, it would be Ramasya Danam. So if it is Indra, it would be Indrasya Danam. Indra's gift, Rama's gift, and so on. So he guessed that this must be gift notations. And based on these three letters and some very brilliant guessing and some correlation to the early script, actually it was related to the later Sanskrit script. He just had to make guesses. And you know, he also had coins with these inscriptions which could relate to the Greek. So based on all this, he managed to guess it and completely decoded the entire script in 6 weeks. He slaved night and day to do this. He deteriorated his health. He was 39 at that time. 38 or 39 at that time.
There's a lot of sand from the background. Can you say something in the mic? People at the back, you can hear a lot of sand over here. Kuncha Kamiya Kasmariba, please. Thank you.
I am the one who usually gets the title of Adhika Prasangi, but okay. Rivals. Cool. That generally means that you are bored a little. I'm sorry about that. I wish perhaps a more exciting speaker or a more exciting topic. So he decoded this line, this famous inscription that found us all over. The first line is Devanam Piya, Devanam Piya, Piya Dashi, Laja Evam Aha. This is translated to thus Devanam, Devas, Piya, Priya. This is the Sanskrit or Pali translation of the Sanskrit phrase, the beloved of the gods, beloved gods being the Devas. Evam Aha is spoke. And this was confirmed, Devanam Piya Piya Dasi. So Devanam Piya Piya Dasi spoke, but who was Devanam Piya Piya Dasi? There is no mention of anybody called Devanam Piya Piya Dasi. But at this point, his friend George Turner was in Kandy and was getting help from the Buddhist monks there. They actually gave him a copy of the Sri Lankan history called the Mahavamsa, and also a document that the Buddhists used that was commentary to the Mahavamsa. He got both of them. And this really blew open a lot of information, and the communication between Turner and Prinsep enabled him to understand. First, he thought there was a Sri Lankan kill called Devanam. His name was Devanam Piya Tissa, and he thought that confused him. So he thought this Tissa, all the monuments in India, the pillars were done by a Ceylonese king. They said that makes no sense. We have no record of a Ceylon is king, and it was not there in their records either. But later documents said one of the kings, I think Parakramabahu, asked Devanampiya Dharma Ashoka to send his son and daughter as messengers to spread the message of Dharma and a sapling of the Bodhi tree at Bodh Gaya. Oh, now we know Ashoka. Ashoka is there mentioned in one of the references to Chandragupta as the son of Bindusara and the grandson of Chandragupta. And this Ashoka, no doubt, was the great Ashoka. And then he started, read the scripts at this. The other thing happened. He discovered not only were the scripts similar from all the pillars, they were exactly the same. The text was same letter for letter, and they were the same in a lot of the edicts, but there are some additions and subtractions. And then he looked at it, it looked like the Ten Commandments, because this was Ashoka instituting all his commandments on his way of how a country should be ruled. What, that thou shalt commit no harm, thou shalt not kill, those words that Ashoka had written, propagating the faith of the Buddha, talked about Ashoka feeling guilty about having gone to the Kalinga war, killed so many people, felt revulsion and repentance. And to change this, he issued an edict saying that his dharma would be established all over the country, non-violence would be practiced, hospitals would be created for not just men but also for animals and birds, dugs, wells would be dug, rest houses would be created, teachers would be honored, religion would be respected, laws would be observed, all the entire commandment of Ashoka. This was the discovery of Ashoka. 200 years back, the Indian public had no idea who Ashoka was. They had no idea who Chandragupta was. They had no idea who the Gupta dynasty was. They had no idea who the Pallavas were, the Chalukyas were. They had forgotten all of that. 1,000 years, 2,000 years of history was forgotten. All we remembered were the Ramayana, the Mahabharata and the Puranas. In some references, things like in Tamil Nadu, for example, the Cholas and the Pandyas are remembered because the Vaishnavism and Shaivism lasted. And some king here and there, like Vikram and Betal, in minor legends bounded here and there. Very few scholars knew about our history, but the general public only knew about Ramayana and Mahabharata. They did not know any of our history. They did not know about our Greek kings. They did not know about our Kushana kings. They did not know about Dharma Ashoka. They did not know about the pillar. They did not know about the edicts. They did not know about the accomplishments. Ajanta was lost. It was discovered in 1815. The paintings made no sense to them. All this in a period of 10 years. Princeps discovery, the decoding of the Brahmi of Ashoka, and all this. So, this was Princeps' great contribution, and this was continued by Cunningham. And the other contribution that Cunningham made, Princeps died when he was 40, Cunningham continued. When Cunningham took over, that was when the period of the railways was starting. And Cunningham was saving monuments all over India, because they would use the bricks and the pillars of existing monuments to do railway sleepers. So he had to go prevent them. That was his great task. But that's a story for another day. This big detective story based on coins, based on literary sources, understanding of some grammar, some understanding of architecture but not much, and of course and archaeology mainly, is the story that really excited me, and this prompted me to go to Bihar and Orissa and all that year back. And I hope I have told that story moderately well. I hope you enjoyed it. I'll finish with one more slide, I think this one, because after Cunningham came a person called Ferguson. Ferguson, you see what this is, right? The one on the left is a standard Gopuram that you would see in most of South India. The one on the right is a Orissa style temple. Ferguson classified these into the left one into Dravidian architecture, the right one into something called Nagari or North Indian architecture. And then the third one is the Chalukya dynasty, he called, and Chalukya, actually it was the Hoysala architecture, but he called it the Chalukya architecture. So he was the first Westerner to give a kind of a categorization of Indian temple architecture. And he was wrong about some things, right about some things, but that's the categorization that we live with today. But that's subsequent to the great mysteries that were solved by Jones, Prinsep, Cunningham, Todd, Hodgson, Turner, and all the great stalwarts. So, this is really what Brahmi looks like, by the way. I finish with that in literally 20 seconds. This is A-A-E-E in Brahmi. No wonder you can't recognize this. That is Ka-Ka-Ga-Ga. Actually, the Tamil script also derives from that. So this would be Kaka, Kiki, Kuku and all that stuff. And I learned all this, and the entire edge of this is all Brahmi lettering. And I learned all this part of a Tamil heritage group. I talked before I finished with that. We think of Indian history as the Hindu period, the Muslim period and the British period. I already, in my opinion, think the British period should be looked at in three segments. I think even the Hindu period should be called a period of multiple different dynasties, right? The Jain, the Huna, the Hindu, the Greek, the Kushana, and they were not necessarily overlapping or subsequent. They're mostly overlapping in different regions. And the Muslim period is really the Muslim North and the Hindu South. And most of this I learned after being part of, besides my own independent world, I learned as part of being the Tamil Heritage Group. The third person on the left is Professor Swaminathan, who's honored me by being here. And to him I owe a lot of my knowledge besides
these two books.
And a third book called Asiatic Society, B.O.P. Kejriwal. This book is a book called India Discovered by John Kay. And this is the fundamental source of my discovery of
Indian discovery,
Indian history discovery. So thank you very much.
Connections for architecture students and perhaps architects. If you see that the Orissa temple there, and you see the, you know, the circular and the square, and the circular and the square, you see the Peritonis tower in Malaysia. It is, if you see it in plant, that is how you will see it. So I think that many of these common, Petronas tower, in Malaysia. So I think if you see many of these things in plant, you will see that while things change, they still remain the same. And I think maybe that is one interesting thing that architecture students can try and see from these forms how, you know, we also learn from it, but we improvise on it and then take it to another level. So I just want to thank you very much, Mr. Gopu, for your speech. I'm sure I must say that for architecture students, maybe they would have liked a little architectural detective work. Next time, I'm sure there will be something more. I want to thank Ms. Naveera for all her help in arranging this lecture, and of course to Miyasi and Professor Altaf Ahmed. Thank you everybody, and hope you'll all be there for our next lecture. Sujata Shankar would now like to give a small token of our appreciation to Mr. Gopu.